Microservices, quite a hot topic these days. Everyone's talking about it, a lot of large companies are using it, and of course it's a topic of discussion in the interviews. But what exactly are microservices? Hello world, my name is Monis and today we will talk about microservices. At the end of this video, you will be able to clearly understand what microservices are and why do we need them, what problems do they solve, and when not to use microservices. So without further ado, let's get started. If we take an example of any e-commerce website like Amazon or eBay or Walmart, there is a lot going on behind the scenes. Applications like these have a lot of complex features running under the hood, and maintaining all of that is no easy feat. There are different teams for managing different aspects of the application. For example, a team to work on the browse and search part of the application, a team for cart and checkout, a team for account management, and a team for maintaining the UI and UX of the application. Not so long ago, these teams usually had a single codebase, and every person from these different teams used to add their changes to this central codebase. Ultimately, all this was packaged in a single heavy unit and deployed on a set of computers so that the public could access it. These kind of one unit for everything applications are called monolithic applications. Now, although this monolithic approach works, it comes with its own set of problems. Let's take the example of changing the color of a button. The code to do this could probably be a single line, and if you wanted to change that, you'd have to repackage the whole codebase again into a new unit and deploy on the computers. This process could be quite cumbersome for a small change. Therefore, a lot of organizations started clubbing the changes from various modules over a period of, let's say, 2 weeks and deployed multiple changes altogether. This meant that the frequency of changes was quite low. And if something went wrong in one of the features, the complete set of changes had to be rolled back, fixed, and redeployed. Another problem is scalability. Now, a lot of people browse and search for products on the e-commerce websites. They go through a lot of stuff and then they decide whether to buy something or not. Even if you intend to buy something, you go through a lot of items to find that one perfect article that would fit best to your requirements. Now, thinking a little bit from a technical perspective, the browse and search part of the application receives a lot of traffic compared to the checkout part of the application. Even if a customer goes through an average of 10 products to just buy one, we can simply say that the browse and search receives 10 times more traffic than the cart and checkout. And that is assuming everybody buys a product. This number could of course change on a number of factors, like the popularity of the website, percentage of people not buying anything but just browsing, and so on. Now, a food for thought is, although we need high-powered systems to manage the browse and search requests, but we only need 10 to 20% of the firepower for cart and checkout. And this goes down even further for account management modules. I mean, how often do we really change our email addresses and these type of things? Quite rarely.
So, if there is an upcoming Christmas sale, which will increase the load on the website by, let's say, double, which means we might have to scale up and add more servers. Now, we do expect the load of search and checkout to probably be doubled as well, but the chances of account management load getting doubled seems quite unlikely. So, in this situation, it is not possible that we scale some parts and skip the others. This is not optimal from an architectural perspective, nor is it cost effective. Now, these are not the only problems that we have. A significant challenge in a monolithic system is handling faults. Now, imagine a case where there is an error in account management module because of which the whole application cannot function. In this case, it is not possible to isolate this fault. Although there might be nothing wrong with the browse, search, and checkout, they cannot be used as long as account management is not fixed. So as you can see, a large monolith brings a lot of problems with it, and to solve these problems, microservices came into the picture. Microservices came with the idea of dividing the whole big application into logically separate modules, each of which owning a single responsibility. For those who have been in the software engineering for quite a bit of time can consider microservice architecture as a flavor of service-oriented architecture. Now, when we roughly try to split this e-commerce monolith into microservices, we can have the browse and search as one service, which deals with homepage, browsing and searching for products, and these kind of things. And then we can have cart and checkout, which deals with adding items to the cart and the journey to place the order, including the payments. And then we can also have account management, which deals with the account side of things like change and view email, addresses, passwords, and viewing order history. So each of these modules can have their own teams, which would be responsible only for this part of the project and can be quite agnostic to any other team. Similarly, they all can have their own databases. Depending on the requirements, each module can have its own database and can choose the database technology accordingly. For example, cart and checkout teams can decide for something like Postgres for managing transactions, whereas browse and search could have a NoSQL database because of high performance and less need of concurrent transactions. Each of these modules can also implement their code base in different technologies. For example, the account management team can decide to create their code base in Java, while other teams are free to decide on other programming languages. Now, separating all of these services is cool, but how will these services be connected with each other? For example, a person browsing something wants to add an item to the cart and buy it. In a monolith service, it was quite easy because we have the same code base which could interact with different modules inside of it. But now that the services are separated, how will the browse service tell the cart service, "Hey cart, add this jeans to the cart"? And once the user places the order, how will this order appear in the order history? So there has to be some sort of communication between these microservices so that they can talk to each other and delegate responsibility when needed. Let's explore that a little more. The communication between microservices can happen in a variety of ways. A very common way of communication is through HTTP REST APIs. So each microservice can have a bunch of computers running behind the scenes. This set of computers or servers is called a cluster. Each cluster can have an IP address or a URL. Just like we type in a web address to reach a website from our browser, these microservices can also be reached using these IP addresses. Now, each microservice can expose a set of actions that you can perform on those microservices and can also specify what data it needs to perform those actions. For example, the cart service can expose a REST API which can take some basic data to add an item to the user's cart. So when we click Add to Cart from the Browse feature, it sends a REST call to the cart service. And the cart service adds two quantities of this product to this user's cart and returns a success message back so that we as users can see that the item has been added to the cart. Similarly, this service can expose different endpoints to perform different actions like remove items from the cart, check out, place orders, and so on. Although these HTTP REST APIs are quite a common communication practice, microservices can also communicate in a different way. For example, when a user places an order, we want to do multiple actions with this order data. For example, updating the order history so that the users can see the order in their profile. Sending email to the users, like an order confirmation email. Sending order details to the warehouse so that they can ship the products to the user. Send order details to analytics. All of these actions require order details like the items in the order, total order amount, shipping address, billing address, and so on. Assuming all of these actions are handled by different microservices, we can either make multiple REST calls to different places or we can publish a message with order details at one common place from where all microservices can read this message. There are quite a few technologies which have this messaging system, and one of such technologies is called Kafka by Apache. So when we publish a message using Kafka to a topic, these services which are supposed to read our messages can be provided access to this topic. So when we send a message, the services can read it and perform their actions accordingly. So this is another way of communication. Now, once the microservices have been separated and their communication is correctly established, we can now talk a little bit about how it solves the problems that we have discussed before. Remember the example we took for changing the color of a button? Well, with microservices, we no longer have to repackage the whole application into a single unit and do a heavy deployment. We just have to repackage the smaller chunk of the application, which only deals with the front-end side of things. Other features like browse, search, cart, and checkout no longer have to be even touched for this change to happen. This also enables us to ship out features much faster. With better modularity, it now becomes feasible to scale up certain parts of the application. The browse and search traffic, cart and checkout traffic, account management traffic, all can be scaled separately and according to the expected traffic. Another advantage is fault isolation. This is quite a decent advantage of microservices. Imagine that in a monolith something goes wrong and the whole application goes down and the user will see this. However, in microservices architecture, if something goes down in the account management module, only that module suffers. The remaining parts of the application, like browse, search, and checkout, will still continue to work, which means that the user could still place orders. So microservices solve a lot of problems that come with monoliths, but these advantages don't come without a catch. Since now the services are separated, they no longer are tightly coupled. But this means that they have an extra communication overhead between the services. It simply means that since microservices communicate to each other over a network, there is also a problem of network latency, which can make the application relatively slower. Another pain point with microservices is that it is quite difficult to manage transactions across different services. In a monolith, it was quite easy to perform transactions as there was a single code base in a single technology. So you could just put everything that you want to update in a single transaction block. However, when microservices are separated, the transactions can span over multiple microservices and have to be explicitly handled. For example, when a user places an order, the inventory or the stock has to be decreased. Now this inventory management could be handled in a different service altogether, and now the transaction has to be maintained across different services. This can become quite complex when more microservices are involved in a transaction.
So as you can see, there is a lot of baggage that comes with microservices, but that doesn't mean that we cannot handle this baggage. There are design patterns which we can use to mitigate these problems, but that's a topic for another video. So we talked a lot about microservices and how they solve a lot of problems, but that doesn't mean that microservices are a solution to everything. There are very specific use cases for which monoliths are actually a really good fit. For example, if you're working at a startup which is undergoing a lot of changes, it might be a wise decision to go ahead with a monolithic architecture. For smaller projects, it's actually easier to work on a single code base rather than having the complexity of microservices. So there you have it, some fundamentals about microservices. Write down in the comments below if you have any questions. See you in the next video. Bis dann.